for 3 months. He couldn't go back home because there were no means for transportation. Nobody had a car, and the trains didn't run yet. Eventually, after 3 months, we did get back home. We found our apartment completely looted. And my father, that we left him behind, wasn't there. Any place he inquired, nobody knew what happened to Mr. Wiener. Then they came to us from the Judenrat, which was the old committee, and they told something to my stepfather, which I'll never forget. We know that your husband is missing, but we are also aware of a pit of victims thrown in by the Germans. We are going to open that pit tomorrow in order to identify those victims. So the following morning, my stepmother, my older brother, myself, my younger brother was too young, we went to that location, and people volunteered to dig out, to exhume those bodies, to identify them. What about to happen, the Germans picked up at random 38 people in our town, both the Jews, some Christians, and the shot. They shot them not to be killed instantly, they shot them to bleed, to suffer until they expired, and then they threw them into a pit, not their normal fashion, the way they throw in stones. In the German culture, it is called Schadenfreude. Basically, you are enjoying watching others suffer. That is what exactly what it was. And this happened on September 11, a very infamous day, but this was September 11, 1939. So if they were murdered on September 11, and we tried to identify those bodies 3 months later, it was very difficult, because if somebody is buried for 3 months, the bodies are partially decomposed. So in those days we didn't have DNA. It took a long, long time to identify those bodies. After many, many hours, my stepmother recognized my father's body only by the items that he had in his clothing, like a handkerchief with a monogram or a comb. She collapsed, and for me, at the age of 13, at that point, it was such a traumatic experience, and I really have nightmares till this very day, just remembering the partially decomposed face of my father. I was devastated. The following morning, we took those victims. 10 had never been identified. So we took those victims to give them a proper burial in our cemetery. And people volunteered to prepare a mass grave. In those days, we didn't have earth-moving machinery that you used to see today. It was had to be done manually with shovels. And I was standing for hours next to my father's casket at the 30-year-old boy, talking to him, praying, crying, asking him a simple question. Daddy, why did they kill you? What have you done? I didn't understand it. I didn't understand it at the age of 13. And believe you me, I don't understand it at the age of 85 that I am today. Why did they murder my father? I just didn't get it. Eventually, the victims were buried. This is a monument erected after the war by the Polish government. It's in the Hebrew language, and my father is number 23. And this is the official document that I received in 1953, 8 years after the war, from the Polish government, that my father was murdered 11 Rzeszen, which in Polish means September 1939. Life was very, very difficult. Every day, the Germans issued new orders to make our life livable. One of the very first orders was that I could not go to school anymore. My formal education ended at the age of 30. If I wouldn't have made an effort after the war to educate myself, it would be very, very bad. When I come today to a school, And I make the kids aware of how lucky they are. I'm not a jealous person, but I envy them that they have a chance to go to school when they are young, when they have no other obligations, but responsibilities, and they can study.